They loved
channel manager part
people. Rice Gum for what he was doing.
What, bringing more than three viewers to the platform?
Because I sure couldn't do it. He's got a record label.
In my day,
No, stop acting like you've been around the block, bro. Stop
Tell us about your record here. Label.
Okay, yeah, just jump into it. Hey,
Jericho, guys. You said you once went to a private club that had... You should save that for later.
Yeah, are you gonna just say just the cut the scene comes down?
Oh, dude. Actually, when we had a Scump on the show, it was like our third episode. Nate Schott just immediately first question. Seth's like this, like it's great to be here. Matt's like, why do you and Formal hate each other?
Listen, man, I'm trying to get the headlines so that our podcast gets views. All right. Now, what I will say is I'm really excited to be here because I missed two episodes due to the flu. Mm-hmm. And Jackson and Jack Dunlop did a terrible job while I was gone because now all of the K-pop world hates us.
I mean, you guys have, the mob has been poking that beast for like 3.5 years now.
But you don't understand. Like, Jack Dorsey literally came on our podcast, said that GOT7 is his favorite musical entity, band. I don't know anything about K-pop. And then Jackson immediately start talking about BTS. And K-pop stands.
You said you hated BTS.
Well, I never said that.
I think
what the hell?
I'm almost certain Nate Schott said he hated BTS. I have video proof of it somewhere.
Listen, yeah, it's on there.
The last podcast we did that I was a part of, we got to send a message to The Rock. So really quickly,
okay.
Jericho, this episode is about you. I want to send a message to the world of K-pop. Ladies and gentlemen, here we go. We respect the musical talents of your favorite artists. We respect you and your fandom for those musical artists. We are sorry for being misinformed and not understanding the infrastructure and the foundation of K-pop as a whole and all the other bands and groups that come with it. We are very sorry for disrespecting GOT7. We are very sorry for only focusing on BTS. It came out of ignorance and a lack of information rather than hate and pain. We would like you guys to please... Give us another chance,
podcasts.
And I am so sorry you will never deal with our disrespect again.
In K-pop's name we pray, amen.
Amen.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Courage and Nate Schott Show with the one and only Tucker Boehner.
Hey, thanks for having me. You know what's really great is when you invite me on after you have the founder of Twitter on. So, like, people expect somebody of that tier, and they're just like, who's this scrawny-ass white guy just sitting here?
No, dude, listen, last episode we talked about the most high-level stuff we've ever spoken about on the Courage and Nate Schott Show.
Yeah.
Changing the world, the future of Bitcoin in Africa, all this intense stuff.
Wow.
And then here we are. Now with Jericho.
I want to know how smart that guy is.
Where I just think this is about to be a damn train wreck.
It's not going to be a train wreck.
No, in a good way. A good train wreck.
Yeah, it'll be different.
Is that possible? Like a train wreck from Fast and Furious.
Everybody, the train just explodes, but nobody gets hurt somehow.
Yes, that's what I mean. Like... That's what I mean. No, this one I'm excited for because I'm a little annoyed we're not filming this on a Friday afternoon.
Oh, man.
Because I don't think I've ever hung out with Tucker. Without some form of alcohol,
we
in my
can
body.
Start.
I have a ton of alcohol in my office.
Dude,
right
we
now.
Can't. Let's we do, can't. We
let's
have a big
rip
day today.
A shot, one shot right now.
I'll
what is
go
that gonna
get.
Do? Run it back.
I have spicy water,
bro. It is 10 a.m. I have a cup of coffee. I ate some nondescript fast food before I came here. So mixing in some tequila, you got the good stuff.
We were joking before we started. Member of the Forbes 30 Under 30.
Yeah.
Member
you're
of the
not
Forbes
on.
30 Under 30.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not on it.
You have to do something very important and worthy of that list that sets you apart, and currently you just stream. So...
And
I have a ton of streamers on there. Well, first
well,
off...
most of them all change the game, you know,
hey,
or something.
Let me just hear about what exactly was yours.
Well, you see... As the, I think it was the third year of gaming, so there weren't a lot of streamers on there.
Okay.
And they highlighted my charity work. So
brilliant.
You know, all you have to do is do charity.
You guys are lame. I was on that list 2015. I peaked early and way too early.
Yeah,
I really missed the boat.
How old were you? 23?
22. I was. I was around 22, 23.
Booga is 16, right?
Yeah.
There's her, and Ewok is 14.
Yeah,
they're both on Forbes 30 Under 30. Ewok not even halfway to 30 and is on Forbes 30 under.
Jack, you're running out of years. You're running out of years.
Yeah, close. I know. I have five more, so I better do something cool.
Okay, so really quickly, I want to give Tucker the proper introduction.
Sure.
Because I always joke around that nobody ever believes that his name actually is Tucker Boner.
It is.
But this is Jericho. He's been a longtime friend of mine. He's basically one of the founding fathers of gaming content, in my opinion, in live stream format, also on YouTube. Mm. And it's a testament to his creativity and his personality to still be here in 2020 doing this and being this relevant and crushing it on many different fronts besides gaming and gaming alone. But he's got over 1.1 million followers on Twitch, over 1.2 million subs on his main channel on YouTube. Obviously, what we just talked about, 2018, Forbes 30 under 30. And this is the part that makes me the most proud to be his friend because he's diversifying. He's the owner of an independent record label, which is called Night Mode, which has done a fantastic job from a promotional standpoint and the visuals.
Thank you.
I really am a big fan of your announcement and the things you've been doing with it, which I'd actually love to get an update on how that business is going.
Dude.
And even maybe like a foundational story of why you started it.
Yeah, yeah. So I've always wanted to be in music, and I think they can attest, especially since I really don't think I've hung out with you too much, just sober. I love music, and I always have for a long time. And when I was growing up, I tried to produce music, but I'm tone deaf. I can't work like a digital audio workstation. You know, it's like it's a whole new trade. So I gave up on that. It was miserable. And then like 2.5 years ago, my co-founder, Dan, who currently owns Disciple Records and was an artist himself for about 8 years, he came to me and was like, hey, you know, I think this would be a really cool way for us to merge like music and gaming together if we wanted to do like a curated album where you go and you go through our catalog and you choose like the songs that you want. We'll give you like 8 new ones and like 8 re-releases. We'll compile it. It'll be your album. And we'll put it out. And then in 6 months, it got to be their most successful release they've ever done under that label. It got 7 million streams in total.
Wow.
Like 22,000 pre-saves on it. And we were like, can I curse on here?
Yeah.
Yeah. We're like, oh shit. Like, this is actually something that we could extrapolate and make into like a full-fledged business model if we keep that same format of like promotion and curation and don't try and like follow in the footsteps of music labels that traditionally are like, we like to do house music or we like to do rock music. We're kind of like everything under the electronic music umbrella. So we started that about 1.5 years conceptually. And then we launched it in November 29th was our first release. And then since then, we've had 4 releases. We've got an EP coming out at the end of February, new single this Friday. I don't know when this episode goes live. And it's been crushing. Like, I've had some of my personal favorite artists release with us. Feed Me, Unlike Pluto, are two like pretty renowned artists. So for me, it's just been fun to participate, like you said, in something that's not gaming. Like, I've done gaming for 10 years now. So it's nice to have like something to do outside of that, that was a hobby, just like gaming was a hobby, but now I'm trying to turn it into a business.
I love it. And I love the fact that in that sentence or in that description, you said extrapolate. I don't think I've ever heard anybody use the word extrapolate in a real-time sentence.
It's that Wordly Wise or whatever that book was growing up in school.
Oh, I remember that. You also said the word accost earlier when you were close to the microphone.
And I think renowned was correct.
Okay.
It's renowned.
One of those two, I'm pretty sure.
I think this plays in pretty well, this, because Matt mentioned how he shouted out The Rock in the last episode and wanted him on our Courage and Aid Shot show.
Oh, yeah.
For Night Mode, what's an artist that you would love to have that you can call out right now?
Man. See, it's crazy because I would love to work with... Man, I'd love to work with Bauer. He's a super talented artist who kind of has his own sub-label, but he's been, you know, most people probably know him from Harlem Shake. But since then, he's just... Exactly.
Wow. Did you just... Were you the audio for
it? That's incredible.
Whoa.
Guys?
No, he's a really talented musician. He really came into his own after that. Like, that blew him up. But I'd love to work with him. The tricky thing with music is like there's exclusivity clauses and stuff, so it's not
imagine.
Like I can't even be like, I'd love to work with The Rock, I mean, or Shaq. You know what, Shaq, DJ Diesel, get him on my label. Like,
all right,
you know,
it's tough. It actually kind of reminds me, it has a lot of parallels of like talent in gaming right now. It's like as an organization, we want to work with a loads of talent, but they all have their own representation, their own lines of business, and it's not like they can just jump over and be a part of 100 Thieves. So
yeah,
it's probably even more complicated, dude, and convoluted in music.
One of the big points for making the label was like, there's a, everybody knows, like, searching for like sad or like non-copyright sound on YouTube and just taking one, and it just all sounds awful, right? Yeah. So as a creator first, I'm like, okay, well, can we make our music free to use for any content creator? The answer is yes, because we own the label and the songs, but then you get other people like Feed Me involved, and they have like exclusive publishing deals. So you may get to release a song, but like the people that decide if it goes in a commercial or like if people can even use it on YouTube, that's just a bunch of dudes in suits who are 180 years old. So now you're like fighting against them to make sure that it's cleared. And sometimes they have two or three publishers and they don't agree. It's like, you know, you're trying to like swim upstream in an industry that's been the same way for 100 years now.
Yeah. Isn't it kind of funny how I always feel like across any industry I hear about the suits that are 180 years old? Like, when did yeah. Has that always been in business, where like back in the 60s where they're like these World War I boomers that are controlling everything, these back in the Great Depression days? Like,
right.
Has there always been that, or is that now just like a, now with our woke, I guess, generation we are, where we're like,
you don't think somebody was like, that boomer Caesar, like, I'm going to go stab him in the stomach?
Right?
Like, no, 100% there has to be, like, isn't that just, like, the natural progression of things when you're, especially, I think it's, like, magnified now that you live to be 100 years old, right? But, like, if you're dying when you're 60, there's only so much differentiation between the guy who's 35 and the guy who's 55 in terms of, like, you've lived, you know, so much longer. But now if we're 20, yeah. 20, 30, and you have somebody who's 90, that's a huge gap. That's three times your year, or your age. And they're going to have a way different perspective, worldview, et cetera. So, like, I bet you it existed, but definitely not as bad as now.
I want to be safe here really quickly because of how badly you pissed off the K-pop fans. I don't want the World War I boomers to be upset with us. World War I was far before the Great Depression.
I don't think there's... I'm pretty sure there's yeah, none that are still alive.
I'm just covering all of our bases.
Yeah. World War I was 1917.
They do have a huge social media presence.
The Courage
that's
and
102 years ago.
The Courage and Nate Shot show is neutral. We don't want anybody to be angry with us. There's got to be somebody alive from World
Somebody's
War I.
Somebody's printing off
Matt,
like a...
And Matt, before this episode started, said he wanted this to be filled with drama.
Oh, it's a whole episode.
Right, he was like...
I'm going to ask...
Jack?
I'm going to ask Tucker about Jake Paul, porn stars, so many different things. But really quickly, I do want to remind everyone something very important. We got excited. Tucker's here. Great friend of ours. It's a great time to hang out. But the Courage and Nate Shot Show is brought to you by Cash App. Woo! And if you don't use Cash App, then fuck you.
That's a slogan.
Since you already know, Cash App is the simplest way to send or receive money. Buy Bitcoin and invest in the stock market with as little as $1. Cash App would love to provide a bit of untold history of the video game industry, since we all could learn a thing or two. Are you ready? I actually don't know this. What
Tell
the
me.
Fuck?
Wow.
What in the world? In 1724, Matthew von Haig invented the first true iteration of Frogger, but instead of crossing the road and dodging cars, the game involved eating frogs to avoid getting scurvy.
Ooh.
In 1867, Gene Guy Robinson, inspired by his neighbors to the south, created Civilization II, Canadian edition. Fun fact, researching ice hockey automatically wins you the game.
Oh, that's a Civ. You don't get Civ. You probably never played Civ. You played Civ?
I played Civilization.
I played Civ, I get it.
Let me finish. In 1971, Jack Dunlop successfully kicked his own shadow's ass, inspiring the release of the iconic game Pong 1 year later. And in 2013, originally intended to finance Candy Crush addiction, Cash App was founded, and the rest is history. Cash App, that was pretty creative. I will give you points.
Can you imagine if Cash App literally was created? Somebody's just like, I need more Candy Crush. Like, and Cash App's like, all right.
I got you guys.
It's time for us to step up.
Here it is.
Finally, we are stoked to be working with Cash App. We're still doing this, and this makes me really happy, so please pay attention. Everything else was just jokes. We love Cash App, but this is one of the greatest initiatives that I've ever been a part of, and it makes you guys actual real money. We are stoked to be working with Cash App to support the Gamers Outreach Foundation. When you sign up for Cash App and use the promo code THIEVES, THIEVES, not only will you receive $10 to spend on Pogs and Slap bracelets, but Cash App will donate $10 to Gamers Outreach, which is an amazing organization founded by Zach Weigel that provides video games to kids in hospitals while they're dealing with long-term treatment. Guys, if you download Cash App and you don't have it prior to hearing this, if you sign up using the code THIEVES, you will get $10 for free that you can spend on anything you want, and we'll donate $10. Cash App will donate $10 to sick kids in hospitals they play video games.
How many V-Bucks is that?
$10 worth of V-Bucks is, oh, Jesus.
1,100?
1,350, I think.
There
maybe
you go.
Maybe actually
free skin.
Tucker, do you play Fortnite anymore?
No.
When's the last time you played Fortnite?
I did it for a charity event. The last time I like literally booted it up, I think, was when season 2 came out, and I played for like 3 hours and got shit house hammered.
Chapter two.
Yeah, sorry, chapter two, 2 years ago. Yeah. No.
Well, hey. Tonight's a new season.
I know. I'm excited for you guys.
Thank you.
I will say I don't watch
Fortnite. Don't say you guys. Don't rope me into this.
You were not part of the you guys. I was talking, I do tune into all of their like major events things. Like I think I watched your perspective for the Star Wars stuff because I think that is the coolest shit. It's like full scale things. They're the first to do it, and they do it really well despite all of the issues everybody complains about.
Can you imagine being 10 years old watching this happen in your favorite video game?
No.
My mind would be blown.
Oh, instead, we just get like really shit Gmod like models, like really crappy like Source filmmaker videos, and you're like, this is what would happen if Shrek was in TF2. Yeah,
bro, back in the day playing Halo 2, I had old ass men convincing me that if I go on Beaver Creek on top of where rockets spawn and I shoot into the wall twice and beat down and a bunch of other combinations.
Yeah, it's a super jump.
Super jumping was incredible.
Yeah.
But this was something like other Master Chief Spartans will come out of the walls and like shoot people for you. I thought it was the coolest thing. That shit is literally happening in Fortnite for these young kids.
Mm-hmm.
Like they tune in on a Saturday, like it's a cartoon.
It's insane.
And giant mechs fighting each other, the world exploding, going in a black hole. For a lot of the things that I don't like Fortnite has become, they have done a fantastic job of becoming something that is really at the forefront of creativity and gaming.
This will be the last part we have to talk about with Fortnite, because I know that's a hot topic, but it's pretty crazy to think that in a game like this, you can be Batman with a lightsaber from Star Wars and ninjas, like have Batman's cape on ninja, and then fight against John Wick with
that's insane.
With the Scarlett Johansson pickaxe, like all the different collaborations they've done. It's ridiculous.
Yeah,
I wish I could play Fortnite. I wish they just had a creative way to figure out to lower the skill cap.
They need a non-Adderall playlist for me. Yeah. Like literally,
how many MGs need to be in my bloodstream to be in this playlist?
It's like you have to like do a blood prick test, and it's like 35. Go on in, Timmy. Like,
get in there, bro. You're in.
Yeah. I mean, you'd be fine, but the issue is that you can't play with anyone. Because in the second you play with us, dude, I was playing with my little cousin Charlie. On Thanksgiving, he was like,
oh no,
can I play Jack? Because like, he knows everything I do. Dog, we're playing. I'm in the top 1%. I'm like in a huge build battle. I die. I look I'm like, come on, Charlie, you got it. He's like on the ground like this.
Just drooling on
dead.
Himself.
Just dead. I'm like, well, this isn't going to work. So, yeah.
So
we'll figure that out.
How are you spending the majority of your time if you're not playing Fortnite? I didn't know other streamers play on Twitch. Or
yeah,
Twitch
no. It's pretty much
Fortnite.
Just Fortnite and just chatting, and there's nothing
else.
Yeah,
I love shitty cooking.
It's God, so good.
I think that's like the best thing I fell ass backwards into, because the fact is that I get to do meal prep, albeit not very well, and then you know, like people love it because they like seeing like a disaster in slow motion. It's like watching a slow-mo car crash, but most of the time somehow it comes out edible, and that's like the real gem, is like thankfully I didn't waste all this money on food, and I do usually eat all the shit that I make, even if it's not like very pretty. So I'm hoping that by like 3, 4, 5 years from now I'll be able to make something edible for other people, but we're not there yet.
Question for you.
Yeah.
We just got the new 100 Thieves house.
Yes.
Soon will be revealed. I'm just assuming.
Yeah, well, I've seen your floor of your bathroom, and I think every video, like...
Yeah. I've done a good job not leaking too much.
Yeah, Ray has also posted a selfie in, like, every room in that house.
Oh,
so.
The internet's got it, like, pieced
together.
There's
a couple rooms they don't know yet. No, they definitely should have. Yeah. But can we do a shitty cooking collaboration in my kitchen?
100%. I've been
our
trying to
kitchen.
Get people on here.
Our kitchen. My kitchen.
But here's the thing. You can't like do any prep work and make sure you have all the right stuff. Like I don't have a mixer or like a rolling pin, so it's just like we got.
I want it to be. I want to literally
oh,
make
it's
it.
Gonna be shit.
I promised my stream, my viewers, a cooking stream for 2 million subs.
Okay,
and then I've always loved watching yours. Maddie and I have watched you, and she had no idea what to expect.
You went to like it. 11 Park Madison, right? One of the best restaurants in the world.
Yeah.
It's going to be just as good.
Just as good. Okay.
Yeah. We can make like chicken parm, which I know you love, right? And then we can make like something that's really hard. Like what if we made like chicken parm sushi or something?
I think.
Whoa.
That sounds miserable. I
love,
don't want to make that.
I love conceptually like what shitty cooking is, because it fits your sense of humor and your personality so well. Whereas like I.
Because it's shit?
For years, yeah. I used to do. I used to make like these milkshakes and make these desserts when like Burger King had these red velvet milkshakes. It became this big thing on my channel.
Yeah,
it was okay. Huge. And so ever since then, I've been talking about doing it, but not actually doing it. But I want to do a cooking series where I make all my mom's old recipes.
That's good. That's how like.
But it won't be shitty. I'm gonna get like a chef to help me.
That's good. You should. I mean, there's so many different.
I'm so excited about it. Actually,
you. When are you gonna do it?
It's happening very, very soon.
Sorry. Right now, tomorrow. Yeah. Cool.
You want to be
Intel.
On it?
Intel. Yeah, dude. I'll cook your mom's recipe. Wait, we do need a chef. I don't want you to taste it and be like everything. just like break down, sobbing. Like you've literally shattered my image of my mother. I'm sorry.
Damn it. This is not what her chicken tasted like.
Oh yeah. My God.
No, that'll be good. I think cooking is one thing that it's kind of becoming more and more cool for people, like especially single dudes to do. I mean, I know a lot of people are lazy and myself included, but it's not, you know, like watching Anthony Bourdain and like Gordon Ramsay, everybody's, there are people that stream Top Chef and like Gordon Ramsay on Twitch, like for 5 hours straight. They just sit there and watch it. And I'm like, dope. Like we're getting kids who arguably aren't going to be eating very well to like at least think of the idea of making good food or food down the line. So I'm for it.
This is going to be a little bit of a switch, but Jericho, who do you hate the most? Gold Glove, T Martin, Syndicate, and Muzza Fuzza.
Oh man.
Yo, Muzza Fuzza owes me $6,000 for rent, and he just disappeared to Idaho. So, like, hey, listen, I.
is that the answer?
No. Guy, that's a tough one. I really think I hate Gold Glove the most.
Oh, here we go.
Yeah. No. I mean, I'm going to see Syndicate soon here, tomorrow, actually, and. I love Tom for like one day at a time. I live with him and I got like 10 years worth of Tom in my life. Mm. You know, when you live with somebody, like you may be great friends, but you just might not be compatible living physically together. Mm. I don't hate him. And I haven't talked to Trevor in a minute, but yeah, Gold Glove, I was just playing Tarkov with him last night and he literally looted my dead body and was not going to give back all my stuff.
No, he didn't toss it, huh?
He wasn't going to toss it. I was like, Brandon, just throw it into a bush. Which would mean I would probably get it back. No, he was like, no, dude, this isn't yours, I swear. I'm like, Brennan.
This seems like a very Gold Glove thing to do.
Yeah, I hate that guy.
I hate that guy. Well, hey, there we go. Boom. Matt, I tried to kick off more of the drama right there.
Okay.
I asked that.
Yeah, okay.
Here we go.
I wish this was a little bit more rated R, because I would have had something real funny to say there. I'm not going to say it.
We're on here with Jericho.
I completely forgot. I know, but it's not appropriate in any way. Muzza Fuzza is
my boy.
Does anybody
Matt, you good, bro?
You gonna be all right?
This happens sometimes.
I wish this podcast could be something.
He'll tell us after the show. He'll tell us after the show.
Wait, Muzza Fuzza owes you $6,000 and you haven't talked to him in like a decade?
He moved back to Montana because he like stopped making YouTube videos.
I wonder
stuff.
What he does now.
Not make YouTube videos, that's for sure. I don't know. People disappear sometimes, and when you're in Montana, that might as well be a different country.
Looking back on the house that you guys started, what was the name of it again?
Gamer Shore.
I used to first
gamer house, by the way, and alongside the creatures, I think they were
wait,
the
wait,
exact
wait.
Same time.
Hold on, this is Hastro here.
And oh my God.
I'd just like to remind you that
first gaming content
we had in a house in North Carolina. Envy, we did this before
that,
you.
That Hastro put. They did this land in 2011, and I was going to college in Wilmington, North Carolina. And this dude, because apparently, like, you know, this was like earlier esports and there was just not a huge budget. This dude, to save money, he would not fly me from Wilmington to Greensboro, which would be like. 40-minute flight. He put me on a Greyhound bus. It took 9 hours. It took me 9 hours to go 3-hour drive. I can't believe it. I'd still hold that in deep in my core. I can't believe
it. I still hold
that.
It against Hastro for dropping me in 2011.
Oh my God.
Yeah, you're right. Hastro, they did have the first gaming house.
They did. And I got dropped by Envy in 2011. I still hold it against
him. I still got my Envy jersey.
We got third at fucking Anaheim, and I got dropped. But I, you know, look back on it, I actually
and
respect
look at
the
me
fact
now.
That he called me as a young kid. He could have just did some dumb shit, but he actually called me and dropped me the right way, which was good.
That's nice. Well, so he's a stand-up dude. So.
Going back to, I actually do agree. Going back to the Gamer Shore house.
Yeah, what a mistake.
Yeah, so
it was like it was literally a frat house. Like you're taking a bunch like three 18-year-olds who, you know, Gold Glove had not gone to college. T. Martin had gone to college for a little bit. I had gone for 1 year and decided to drop out. And we were all moving from like Chicago or Illinois and Portland and Baltimore. And we were trying to get like, man, we and Muzzafuzz was from Montana and Syndicate was from the UK. So we had like this weird amalgamation of people who had never lived with anyone else besides their parents. Now in this house in Santa Monica, the house was built in 1948. Second day we were there, we're streaming League of Legends, screaming. Cops get called for domestic abuse. Cops have to come in and make sure there's nobody like getting beat here. It was just Goldie was feeding as top lane. It was pissing me off. And for the next 3 years, I'm pretty sure our neighbor called the cops maybe once a month, you know, just because he hated us. But rightfully so. We were loud.
You guys were there for 3 years?
Yeah, it was a long time.
What's weird about that house is I have such vivid memories of like I can visualize the house and the front door and the front yard so well. I think I visited that house more than I remember.
Yeah, I think you because this was back when like everybody was living West Side. And if you don't know about L.A., it's West Side, which is awful and really far away. And then there's the central L.A., which is fun and enjoyable. Everybody was on West Side because they hadn't learned yet. You have not been living here long enough to realize the mistake, the error in your ways.
First of all, I've been living here.
Not talking to you. Okay. You're broken. You, on the other hand, like
West Side is incredible.
Awful. So whenever we were over there, it's boring. Every it's time. Like a retirement community.
Well, exactly maybe that's what we enjoy.
Yeah.
And that's wrong.
Sorry that we don't want to go in EDM till 6 a.m.
Yeah, we don't want to go.
Rarely does that
let's
happen.
Let's go to a warehouse party.
I heard that you hate K-pop.
That is not true.
You said you hate
K-pop. I love BTS, and I love all segments of K-pop. I appreciate their fandom greatly.
Only, you only know BTS. Okay, you're doing it for the views.
Stop. Dude, that thread was actually huge on Twitter. It had like 3,000 retweets and like 30,000 favorites. They were actually
you tell me you can't get
really
more than 3,000 retweets?
Don't stop.
Oh, God.
Listen, we respect all the bands in K-pop.
Real hate would get 10,000 retweets, bands, you know? Like, man. I don't pay attention. If it's not trending, then...
Listen, so what do you think was the biggest issue with Game of Shore? Because there was a little bit of a falling out from that house.
There was, because...
What happened?
We lived together and we had all vastly different schedules. Gold Glove was streaming for like 15 hours a day and Syndicate was there for a month and gone for a month. T. Martin would record at 6:30 in the morning and he sucks at recording audio live. So he'll literally his recordings. Hey guys, T. Martin here. Welcome.
I do the same thing for
but like 900 takes. Yeah. And it's so early for all of us here. It was just like, you know, we were all trying to figure out how to be adults, air quotes, because we're still learning.
Yeah.
And just trying to find like our content rhythm. The type of stuff we were making was different. Also, we were just idiots, you know, just doing stupid shit. So like, I don't think there was a major falling out. Like, I'm still friends with most of those dudes, or at most, because I don't know where Muzzafuzz is. But like, you know... That's what happens when you move in with people. If you haven't been to college yet, you're going to find out. You may be living with your best friend and you don't know it yet, or you may be living with somebody you hate.
How many roommates have you had since then?
None. That's not true. I did have my girlfriend live with me for like a year and a half. So outside of that, when I finally moved back here alone, I'm never going back.
I hear you on that.
I'm going to marry somebody and they can live in a different house. And like, I only want to see you from 8 to 10 p.m. on the weekdays and maybe during the weekends.
Like, yo. T. Martin is the most interesting personality in gaming to me because I don't see him often. But when I do, he's the nicest guy. But he is just off on vacations 24/7.
Royal Caribbean basically just go every time they have a new ship or a new vacation, they just go vlog it.
Yeah, I know. And I love that. But like his second channel is like an anomaly to me. I don't think anybody really understands how much T. Martin actually kills it on YouTube still
T-Martin
to this
2.
Day.
T. Martin 2 is his second channel.
It's iconic.
Dude, this man has been doing like, oh man.
Five videos a day.
SSO PKHC was the original like spam uploader, and I guess Vicstar too. SSO PKHC did 8 videos a day for like 7 years. He has 12,000 videos on YouTube. I don't know if he still makes them. And then Trevor or T. Martin told me like, Three years ago, he's like, yeah, you know, I don't really like upload on T Martin anymore. I was like, what do you do? And he goes, oh, my Let's Play channel just fucking slays. And I looked over and I was like, it's like 50 million views a month. And like, I didn't even know. Like,
that is insane, bro. Yeah. And literally, I stayed at his house once a couple of years ago, beautiful house. And dude, his grind doesn't stop.
Yeah.
He does not stop. And that's the beauty of, I guess, what he does. When you mentioned, like, he goes away on those trips, but then, like, they also have a vlogging channel. He's got his main channel.
He's got a channel for his dog.
Dogs. Like, dude, he is business.
He's a workhorse.
He is a workhorse, bro. I always admire his work ethic with that stuff, man.
It could not be me.
Actually insane with
Tucker,
what he does.
Platform wars.
Ooh.
Twitch versus Facebook versus Mixer versus YouTube.
Who has the biggest contract for me?
Sorry?
That's
I
what
thought you
said.
Were going to ask.
Oh, that's what you're
that
curious
about. That was my
about.
Statement. No,
would
no.
Would you leave
just,
Twitch?
Here's the thing about moving platforms. I like Twitch. I just passed my 10-year on Twitch like 2 weeks ago, and I had my 10-year on YouTube this summer. I think that every single platform is interesting, especially with, say, you get a large sum of money, that financial freedom to like do more and different stuff than just stream the video games every single day is really it's incentivizing. Like the idea that you could, I know you're traveling more, but the idea that you could take 4 days off to go travel and you could stream from there and not worry about it being off hours or like viewership's lower, so you're not gonna, you know, your income stream is gonna be messed up. So I think that we're getting to a point where each platform is going to offer something unique. Like Ronda Rousey just signed to Facebook 2 days ago.
She had like 20,000 people watching her play Pokemon yesterday.
Yeah, yeah, like for better or for worse, each platform does have benefits and losses. Like Facebook is huge in Latin America, I think now, and in Southeast Asia, it's just blowing up. And like I'm excited for the platform wars, but only if it means that they're going to offer more and better features for the viewer and also for the creators themselves. Cause like I've been bugging Twitch to do a whole bunch of like show series. I wanted to do Shitty Cooking, but like at a proper studio. And it's like pulling teeth, trying to get any funding for that from a specific platform. And rightfully so, they just don't want to give you free money and be like, here, light this on fire. So, I'm always open to the idea, but that's not to say that I'm like running around going like, hey, get me off of Twitch, you know? I get me off of here. I hate it. I love it. And
that's the exact same thing. That was definitely with everything that wound up happening. I wasn't going around and telling, you know, Loaded or anyone, like, I'm jumping ship.
Yeah.
I was like, who's going to, like, you're dumb in this world if you're not open to hearing it doesn't mean you're think any ill will. It's like, hey, I'm open to hearing what people have to offer.
It's like, go ahead.
Oh, no, feel free.
It's like, I think people get, since we're so early in streaming and this platform in general, and I know it sounds weird saying early after 10 years, but like realistically, it's a blink of the eye in the industry or industries that we're working in, movie, television, all that stuff. When you look at it, it's more along the lines of people who are watching content on certain websites are fans of that website, which is awesome, right? But then they view you as like a player on the team. And when you switch teams, they're like, well, shit, like either you mean I got to go also spend time at this team too? And you see this mentality a lot with people. Some people are like, I can't believe you would leave for X amount of money. Other people are like, well, yeah, you've got 2 years left in this career. Like, go make that paycheck. We wish you all the best. There's no wrong or right way to view it, but I just wish that people, and it will happen over time, I just wish people were less like defensive about their home team and more accepting of the fact that it's just another application or another website. You can have gripes about like UI or usability, but like that I can't believe I have to download another app or go to a different webpage is kind of weird to me.
So let me put you on the spot.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've heard rumors or you've talked to friends or you know what these contracts look like for other people who have jumped ship from Twitch. What's the number that it would take you to leave Twitch?
I'm not going to ever. So two things. There is obviously a number, but for me to say any number out loud would do nothing for me. Like either it's lower than anybody would offer and now I've just boxed myself into a corner, or it's higher than anybody would offer. So I'd rather just say there's a number. And it basically requires me to have financial independence for a very long time.
I was trying to bait you for the title.
Not my first rodeo here.
Blink once in the rest of this podcast if it's $5 million.
A year.
Process. I was like, wait.
I didn't say anything. Here's gonna blink his business email.
No, like it would require financial independence because as much as I love like the record label side of things, that is a passion project and will not make money for a long time if it does make money. Just like streaming is still the thing I enjoy the most. So if I could just do that with less stress overall, great. Otherwise, like, I got 10 more years easy in the tank for this. So, like, if we continue at the same pace, fine by me. Bring it on.
Streaming platforms aside, a serious question. Mm-hmm. Would you have sex with a porn star?
Okay, man, that is a... Do you want to hear a story?
Yeah.
Yeah, whoa.
Okay.
Yeah!
So a year and a half ago, Riley Reed followed me on Twitter, and I followed her back just because, you know, you see it pop up, and I was like, well, that's interesting. And she starts DMing me saying, like, hey, we should hang out, all this stuff. And I was like, cool, that's funny, but, like, I'm good, no worries. Like, it just felt weird, right? And for no less than 4 months, she would DM me, like, once or twice a month saying, like, hey, let's hang out. And on my birthday, she sent me her STD test that was taken from 2 days earlier. And she's like, hey, can I come over for your birthday? And I was like, you're joking probably, but also like, no. And I said, no. And she got kind of upset. Like, she was like, why do you keep saying no? Like, what is your problem? And I explained, and then she got really pissy saying that she was just joking around. And I was like, okay, like, maybe I misread the situation, but like, we both stopped talking in general. Then a good friend of mine is one of the owners of Vixen and Blacked and Bang.com and all that stuff. So he hits me up a month ago and he's like, hey man, you want to come to the Vixen party? And I was like, yeah, sure, of course, like, I'll go. So we go.
It has the word party in it.
It's an invite only party to celebrate the top porn stars on Vixen. I was like, yeah, it sounds fun. And as I walk in, his name's Steve goes, hey, Mike Diesel. He's like, hey, Mike told me about your little run-in with Riley. And I was like, yeah, long story. Like, I think we're chilling. And he goes, oh, no, I'm going to introduce you to her. Oh. And I look at him and I was like, why? Like, no, why? Like, if she doesn't like, if she hates me, then this is now, like, you're going to create a problem. But I forgot that he is essentially like he's the owner of the website, right? So he leaves and brings her, and he's like introducing her to all the people in our group. And like, he gets halfway through and she looks at me and she goes, how do you know this nerd? and then we hug, and I was just like, I mean, I've been friends with him for a hot minute. And she's like, yeah. And then she turns to him and goes, no, but really, how do you know this nerd? And he's like, Tucker's a friend of mine. And she goes, no way. And then he's like, yeah, you guys should go take a photo together. And she's like, yeah, of course. Clearly, like, just like going through the motions. So we go take a photo. I post it on Instagram and I was like, here's your crossover episode. Like, everybody just leave me alone. Obviously, that's not the case. Everybody tags me in every post she makes. And it's
so
just,
you guys,
like,
cool now, though?
Yeah, I don't have any beef with her. We seem chill. She hit me up again to go to an escape room after that, and I didn't respond because I didn't want to rehash
what
the same.
What is going on?
Are you good, bro?
Listen, yeah. Do you want my explanation? You know what? All things considered, yes, we're chill. Yes, it was funny. There's my porn star story. Would I have sex with a porn star? Probably.
I have a porn star story as well.
Here we go.
So back in there
it is. See?
Wow.
She's super nice, by the way.
Well, I'm just saying. So she was STD free, and she wanted to come over on your birthday.
Well,
and you
of course,
just didn't want to have sex with her.
Well, first of all, that specific day I was so hungover.
Here we go.
But right, second right, of all, all right, yeah. Is, well, do you want the explanation?
No, I don't want it because it doesn't matter to me. You said no.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. Yes.
Here
I did say no for this.
You don't have a girlfriend. You haven't had a girlfriend in a very long time.
Oh, we're doing this now. This guy gets a girlfriend for 6 months, and all of a sudden he's out here just like on the fucking mountaintops. Like, I just don't understand.
I'm looking down on all of you.
Like,
no, so funny enough, back in 2013 when I was popping on Twitch, actually I think Rachel Starr was ahead of the game. So growing up, I watched pornography. I still do.
Not anymore. Hey,
talk
but not anymore.
Not
right
anymore.
Right,
I still do from time to time. But
bro,
I was familiar with a porn star named Rachel Starr. Uh-huh. She is known for her assets that her ass sets and
that was clever. I see what you did there. Very clever.
And I watched her from time to time. So randomly she follows me on Twitter while I'm live streaming. I think it was back in 2014, and I follow her back immediately. Then about 10 minutes later she sends a photo over Twitter, and it's her with a low cut top on, and written across her chest, it says, Nate shot here, with an arrow pointing at her boobs.
Mm.
Now,
big move. That's a power move.
I was freaking out inside, and I was freaking out on stream. And then me being the overthinking person that I am, started spazzing out a little bit. I'm like, oh, wait, I'm sponsored by Red Bull and sponsored by all these brands. Because I interacted with a tweet and people were going nuts. Like, people were losing their minds. So was I. And I was so happy. And I sent it to my brother because I know he watched Irritable Star as well.
Nice.
He sent it to all his friends. And
I became watching together. It sounds hometown, like you both are big fans.
I became the hometown hero. And then I sent her a DM like, hey, I'm actually going to delete these tweets. I'm worried about my sponsors and whatever, like a fucking dweeb. And nothing ever came of that. So
literally.
That was my porn star story. But I actually, I do find something actually came later on. So I do find it interesting how there's been such a gigantic crossover between porn stars and the YouTube community.
Is it really that surprising?
It's surprising to me watching it. It's not surprising that it's happened. It's surprising watching it unfold.
Nobody jerks off more than Twitch viewers. I will debate you. I'm guaranteeing the average Twitch user is pumping 2 times a day. like the amount of just chat, like it's not surprising at all. And I think that what you may have caught on to, you said she was ahead of the game. And one of the reasons that I was also like, is because a lot of it is, most of it is like, well, where can I find new fans? And that doesn't mean it's bad. And there's like, that's a really smart move. But like, I'm pretty sure that Riley ended up hooking up with a YouTuber and that, you know, and then doing a bunch of videos with him. And like, that's another way to network. And if that's your, you know, if that's something you like to do and stuff, then fucking hell yeah, like go for it. But also like super smart. There's a reason why like people are porn stars are going to Twitch to stream video games.
I think good thing really it's smart. Empty. I mean, Lana Rhodes and Big Mike are, I think they're dating. I don't really know. I actually like Big Mike as a personality. I'm a pretty big fan of Logan Paul.
Yeah.
Which I think we're gonna try to get him on the show. Mm-hmm. I'm a big fan of what he's able to do with the situation that he's in.
I have no idea what you mean by that.
So okay. So Logan Paul,
what situation is
Logan,
that guy in?
Logan Paul goes through the suicide forest, right?
Yes.
And that was terrible for what it was.
Yes.
And I definitely think it was more than just a lapse of judgment. Like, it was a conscious decision that he was making to put that in a vlog.
Yes.
And I think there was a huge disassociation for, like, reality and views for him. Mm-hmm. And he fucked up. That, like, there's no question that was a mistake.
Right.
But I actually think Logan Paul is incredibly talented and really good at marketing himself and really staying at the top of the game from a social media perspective.
Sure, for better or for worse.
Right, but
I can agree with you. Those brothers are very good at staying in the discussion no matter what they're doing.
My opinions between Logan Paul and Jake Paul are drastically different.
Gotcha. I have not spent any meaningful amount of time watching or engaging with any of their content, so all I've seen are boxing matches, so that's what I'm basing my judgment on, and I have no idea how that how I could do anything with that, you know?
Do you disagree with the boxing matches or like?
No, I think they're great. I watch. I mean, like, who just fought the most recent one?
Jake Paul and
against Gibby.
Gibby on, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that wasn't really much of a fight. That was like the fight before that, fire. That fight, most boring shit ever. At least like I know KSI is like I know him, he's an acquaintance, so it's fun to watch that go down. And I think that if boxing could be entertaining, they're doing a good job at least drawing eyes to the sport, but you know, like, what does that have to do with all of the other stuff they do?
I just think that Logan Paul has a ton of self-awareness on who he is, his personality, his type of comedy, and does a great job of continuing to stay relevant and and staying at the top of people's minds.
Sure.
The reason why I brought it up, though, going back to Big Mike and Lana Rhodes, I think they're dating, and Big Mike does a show called The Night Shift. And when I first started paying attention to it, I wasn't watching it because it was like a long-winded content. I think it was like an hour long. Mm. So I never had that type of time. But I've always seen him in snippets of Logan Paul's content. I always thought it was really funny and really entertaining. And when I paid attention to The Night Shift, I was looking at its views. I wasn't clicking on the video, but it had like 20,000 views probably 6 months ago. And now if you go to his channel, Big Mike is getting like 3 million views a video and he's uploading almost every day.
My man.
It's absolutely insane. And all the thumbnails and the posts of Lana Rhodes in the background and them dating. I don't know the whole story, but I think it's really interesting and really smart by both of them.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to argue with that, but Ricegum did it first. Remember when he was just streaming Call of Duty calling porn stars on Skype?
X-Jaws did it first.
X-Jaws literally did it first.
Pocahontas Jones.
Yeah. Is that? Yeah. I mean.
I remember when Ricegum was on MLG.TV and he was like the face of MLG.TV.
And it's just
porn. The platform was just him calling porn stars. And like, you already know, people from MLG were like, oh my god!
Yeah.
Oh my god!
It was
that was when Maven was one of the head.
They loved
channel manager part
Ricegum for what he was doing.
What, bringing more than three viewers to the platform?
Because I sure couldn't do it. I was gasping for air over on MLG TV. Nobody followed me.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
Hey, but listen, they got you here today.
You're right.
Well, could have been other
Where
places.
Would you be without Sundance Giovanni? Is a question that I ask myself every morning when I wake up.
I would actually be in a terrible place. I'd be doing something that I fucking hated. Mike Sepso, Adam Apicella, and Sundance Giovanni.
Trifecta.
Are my dads. Now there was a lot of things that we disagreed on, but there's a lot of things that you guys helped me do. I love you guys. Mm-hmm. Like weird alcoholic uncles.
Yes.
Which they don't really actually drink that much anymore, which is depressing.
Tucker, what was bigger for your esports career? The Jack Ryan CSGO Invitational or the Dylan Francis Pro-Am?
Pro-Am? Yeah. Fortnite? Man, that's a good question. I think that undoubtedly the funniest clip that I've ever been in was... So picture this. It's Fortnite's big Pro-Am Invitational, right?
The real big one.
The first one they were doing, Bank of California Stadium. I'm partnered with Dylan Francis because, like, you know, he hadn't really played much and we had gotten to talking. And he goes, yo, my Nike rep, I bet you we could get, like, matching tennis uniforms. And I was like, fuck yeah, send it. So it arrives and they're tiny and it's, like, perfect. Ugh. And we realized that, like, nobody else dressed up as, like, a duo. So we get up on stage and we realize, like, the only way for us to get on camera is to either A, win, not going to happen, mm-hmm. or B, to get out early and then just go on a... to go on the interview. So the first match happens, we die like this first team. And they go over to us like, hey, do you guys want to get on the interview? And this is what happens.
Yeah, no, it was a gameplay thing. The thing is, I don't want to show off my skills yet. I want to wait for the duos. So I decided, let's let them think that I suck. And then I'm going to come real hard all over them.
I don't think I've ever seen Justine be speechless.
Dude, what's funny is that, so obviously I know Justine really well, is like, that is her type of humor. But she's like the most brand safe personality on all the internet. She's got a great sense of humor.
Yeah.
And to watch her actually try to hold back from laughing when she's like the brand safe brand was hilarious.
Most of the clips cut off, but they cut away from us. They go to the caster desk where like Lupo and everybody are sitting. And then, Lupo's cracking up. So then they cut to the crowd and the crowd is like 50% kids under 12. And so there's a bunch of people laughing, a bunch of parents like sitting there mad. Justine can't stop laughing. I can't stop laughing. And then after like 30 more seconds of that, they just cut the feed and they go to like the break in between.
As they should have.
Dylan got invited back. I have not gotten invited back. I think it's probably for the best.
One of the funniest parts of that was that I wasn't supposed to be involved. I was like the alternate.
Oh, this really? Like, kind of like your big break on Fortnite.
For one of my Fortnite things, yeah. And next thing you know, the night before, they're like, hey, Summit dropped. Do you want to come play with Kenneth Fareed? I'm like, yeah, like, let's go. They were already bringing me out just in case someone like got sick. Like, I was literally the alternate. So I get there, and they placed me in not only the best seat, but at that day, if you guys remember, it was in the shade.
Yeah, mine was in the shade too.
Mine wasn't.
It was like 90 degrees.
And my peripherals were on fire.
The keyboards they were using had like these metal caps around them.
And they were black.
Dude, if you touched it, I swear it was you were getting a degree of burn.
Well, I can confirm because mine was in the fucking sun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sucks to be so, you.
You, Ninj, I remember all you guys were like dying. And here I am like cranking, like warming up. Dude, that event was so insane because it just brought everyone That was together, bro. Oh,
that was, I mean,
cool.
Even the celeb, like this past year I went to, and it was also really cool.
Yeah.
I just think that like that was when Fortnite was really coming to its own as like a pop cultural thing. Like Marshmell had been playing with Ninja for a bunch, you know, of rounds and stuff. The types of celebrities there were like celebrities that have never really even played a lot of video games, but they were huge names, which was dope. Like, yeah. I think that it was their agents like, hey, we got to get you in on these video game type deals. And it was like a nice break, not only for Fortnite, but
why
also...
Why does their agent sound like they like smoke packs of cigarettes? Hey, come on.
Because they're from New York.
We got to get you in these Fortnite deals.
We got to go to Fortnite.
Dude, Tyrone Woodley was my partner and had never played Fortnite in his life. I'm yeah. like, oh, man.
You know, I did
you a, got a bad partner, brother. I'm not good at this either.
I did a PUBG thing with Deadmau5 like a year and a half ago, and it was me and Diesel and Gold Glove, and our fourth partner was Anderson Silva. I want you to know that not only does he not speak basically any English, but as we taught him how to use his keyboard and mouse, he was using his index fingers to move, and then he would grab the mouse like this and try and shoot. It was incredible.
Dude, I had a surreal moment where I'm sitting there, right? I have Vince Staples directly to my right.
Yeah.
My partner's 7 foot tall, Kenneth Faried of the Houston Rockets, later on the time Denver Nuggets. He opens up his like Louis man satchel, as you want to call it.
Yeah.
And he sits down, he's like, let's fuck people up, and just pours out his satchel, and it's just filled with gummy bears, like ring pops and all this candy. I'm like, all right. Then I look behind me, Murder Beats is yelling at Ty Dolla $ign. I'm like, and Vince Staple gets killed in the next game. He's like, man, fuck these PC bitches, man. I was like, what the fuck is going on right now?
Playing with I think the people in rap probably have the most fun. I think like rap and electronic dance music in general, they play the most video games.
Yeah.
I did an Amazon thing where Vince Staples and Boss came in to play 2K. And for an hour, I didn't even have to talk. It was just them going back and forth about like the most absurd shit. And it's got to be like a cultural thing, because electronic dance musicians and like hip hop and rap artists spend the other half of their time playing video games.
100%.
It's like it's crazy. It's good. Maybe it's like an age thing because they're all the same age as us.
Yeah, I was really drunk at that event.
Yeah.
See, I was so nervous that I was like, I got to do well. So I did it dead sober. And that's where
you soft.
I sat on top of a hill in a metal box, and the zone came towards us six straight times.
Oh, I remember that, bro. You got, yeah.
Unbelievable.
I feel like if I were ever to come on the Courage and H.O.T. show and as like a separate person,
yeah.
I want third place in the warm up solos at the first prime.
You want the worthless accolade ones? Like,
yeah, dude. Like, I don't get enough credit for that.
I actually,
like, when 50, we got 10:55 in Modern Warfare 4.
Dude, when we got sent this, I actually laughed just reading. Like, we get all these incredible notes. Like, we just had Jack Dorsey on, so here we are getting the most. And I'm just reading through these notes, and it's like, had a job as a dancing cow at Chick-fil-A.
True.
Moved to LA. Dot Esports interview, his first paycheck was $4. His biggest gaming achievement was the Jack Ryan CSGO tournament invitational. He also was a Forbes 30 under 30.
Is that below all of the meaningful achievements?
I'm pretty sure Alex just hits the Wikipedia page and copies and pastes.
I love it.
The Jack Ryan invitational high key was hilarious because it knocked me into the top 100 earning North American Counter-Strike players. So like, I put that shit in my title of like every stream I do, and people would come in and be like, there's no way. And just had it hotkeyed. There you go. Like, real professionals earned less than I did.
That reminds me of now Frosty from his Uno winnings.
Number one
earning
Albanian
player. Second is like Uzbeski Uzmaskaskan at like 3K. And then there's Frosty at like $85,000.
That is like the fact that they're throwing money behind. I earned $300 in that Uno tournament. I think I'm still top 100, so I put it in my Tinder bio. It didn't work, but like, I love that there is such weird games that like Uno was incredible. Like, yeah. It's like not an e-sport, and that's what made it fun to watch. And I'm glad that people are like putting more money behind like stupid shit.
Well, we did a $500,000 Uno tournament with Cash App.
You did, and I watched
the first one eliminated.
Oof, tough.
Those double draw fours or whatever.
I got hit with 3+4s. Tell me how that fucking happens.
Damn, hey, man. Dude.
That's I was so mad. Was so mad.
I knew he was going to be mad too, because he also got out on the rule that he argued prior to the show that like basically everyone else was against Matt on him. I was like, this is a dumb rule. And then it hit him during the show, and I was like, oh, Nate's about to fight somebody.
Well, the rule didn't make any sense, man. And it's like, when Maven has an idea in his head that he thinks is right, he will argue tooth and nail like, you're a fucking idiot. This is how it should be played. essentially how it worked was when at the end of every 4 minutes, when the round would be over, if you're tied with cards in with somebody else and you guys might be eliminated, you lay out all your cards and the amount of specialty cards that you have, each specialty card is worth 10 points.
No, oh, points. You're one of the people that tries points. And play like the real Uno rules.
Well, it's because we had to have tiebreakers like that. Yeah, of how
Uno's a game of strategy, dude.
It is, but everybody plays it the drunk way. Get rid of your cards. But in reality, the way you play Uno is like it's a lot of addition. There's like 7 rounds. It's actually fucked up. I remember playing real.
Not in the right place here. All I was we played Uno. I play Uno the right way. Like I play Uno a lot with my girlfriend. And it's just put the card down. Like, it's not, you're not adding anything.
That's not the right way.
Yeah, okay, that's the way I play Uno, though.
I mean, that's the way everybody plays Uno.
The way,
right.
I'm saying the way that we play Uno in the tournament is the way that I play it. But,
right.
I was mad
because you lost,
I'm
really.
Bothered by it. Yeah, true. I hate losing.
Yeah.
Wow. And I was the first one.
You know what? I think Frosty, needed that money more than you. So.
Yeah. That's
imagine you win your own.
The best part is they split it 4 ways for that, too.
Dude, Adelaide. Is just sitting like, I didn't even fucking play. Like,
he had like one activity where he had to use his D1 athlete side of him to go through.
Well, Tucker.
Go ahead. No. I was gonna ask Tucker, what has been in your career the number one thing you get asked to do? Like, do this again.
Is it season three? I mean, that was like back, I know we've spent a million years in like the back in my day section on this podcast, but like when we were doing Mayanite, I was averaging like 20,000 viewers a day. Yeah. It was before Twitch Prime. It was before like subbing was a huge thing. So I had like 1,100 subs, and Syndicate was averaging 90,000 viewers every single day. Like he was the first individual streamer to hit 100K, and he did it like several times, right? And then like 2 years later, Faker did it. And so that was fun while it lasted, really cool, but it's never happening again. And I'm done with like Minecraft is enjoyable, but I'm kind of done.
So there's
with
no
it.
Like One Direction, the tour came back, the tour in 10 years will come back.
I've said this before, give me $1 million and I will do 12 episode series of Mayanite with the original cast. You can pay them whatever they need, but like $1 million for me, because it is so obnoxious. Like it's been 4 years now.
I want $1 million to be back on Mayanite. I was on there for like a couple of weeks. I showed up like once a week.
Literally, they just pop on and they just be like, I don't even know what your role was, but you were there for a bit. And like we had,
I was like Dianite or something.
Yeah, you guys just built like farms of like away from all of us. It was like,
but even now till today, you still get it every.
Yeah, I used to have the word banned just because like I got so tired of it, but now it's like like once a day somebody will come in and it's got to be like some 14-year-old who's like, I watched you when I was 7, still not over it.
And now I'm in college.
Oh man.
Well, this was a pretty good episode, I would say.
Oh dude,
we didn't talk about the brothel though. We got to talk about that at a different point.
Oh, I mean, I'll.
No, I was just kidding.
I was about to say,
I don't think I was at this brothel.
Neither was I, but
allegedly.
I was allegedly not at a brothel.
Yeah, please.
No, Tucker, I mean, I know we went a little bit off course of how we normally interview our guests, but is there anything that you're up to right now that you want to talk about? While we still have time,
Man, you guys got to start drinking that spicy water. I'm serious, like vodka and water.
Man, I drink vodka soda water.
Yeah, but that just makes your water more difficult. If you're in a hurry and you've got to get in your Uber and you have a tall cup of vodka and soda water, you're not choking that down. It's not comfortable. Mm. But vodka and water, it's less effort. Put ice in it.
Didn't you make a diagram of exactly how to do it or something? Like what?
It's
what
as much as you want, man. Like for me. Shot of vodka, fill the rest of the cup up no matter how tall with water. Like, I'd rather go to the bathroom 4 times a day or 4 times at night than I would wake up hungover and thrown up.
So do you swear by your vodka water craze? Like, do you have any other alcohol that night? Like, if you're drinking vodka waters,
sometimes
like,
I'll have
a shot of tequila.
Sometimes you'll have a break beer, in between the vodka waters.
Break beer.
No, I mean, I drink tequila and stuff. The whole thing is just like drink more water. And if you're drinking water while you're already drinking, then it just makes it easier to be more hydrated.
I fundamentally disagree on what is. I know dehydration is one of the main factors of a hangover.
Yeah.
But if you drink 10 spicy waters, you're gonna be hungover.
Oh yeah, but definitely not as dehydrated and hungover as drinking 10 anything else's. And
I agree.
Yeah,
I can agree with that.
I would love a podcast of just you talking about your weird things with drinking and you talking about your food things, like how Matt has his insurance pizzas and stuff. Like,
Insurance
pizza.
Oh,
when you order an extra pizza because you may want to get another pizza later on?
No, the insurance pizza is I order two pizzas in case one is not cooked exactly the way that I like it. If I'm going to eat pizza, I want to ensure...
Tucker, when you give a 15-year-old boy millions of dollars...
He's like, fuck it, two pizzas. Dude. Like, you never know what's going to happen in that oven.
And guess what? It's paid off substantially. Sometimes they'll give you a pizza that was like warmed up from the night before. No bullshit.
You got to stop ordering from bad pizza places.
Well,
then.
Listen.
See, I knew it. Don't even get started. Don't even get started.
I know ordering food better than I would argue anyone else on this planet.
This is a weird hill to die on.
Is there any?
It's the only hill that I want to die on.
What is the vodka of choice for spicy vodka?
Look, man, you can. I'm a veteran. Like, if you want to give me some Vlad, you know, I could choke down some Burnett's vodka and water,
Jesus Christ.
But balling on a budget, New Amsterdam, probably the best vodka for under 20 bucks for a handle. And then Tito's 35, you know, 39.
Look at how much he knows. And this is what I'm telling you. Tucker is naming the cost of vodka bottles like it's nothing, bro.
Bro, you're just not as elevated as me. It's like a whole nother echelon of drinking.
How much is a bottle of Grey Goose?
I had 45 at a Bristol Farms.
Oh my God. Well, how much does it cost at Whole Foods?
I don't know, man. I don't shop at Whole Foods.
Oh. That is true.
It's a little too expensive for me.
Oh, they must not have Whole Foods in Central LA.
Oh, true.
Oh, there's one on that's the west side. Doxing me. there's one within a 1 mile radius of my home.
Here we go.
To the left.
To the left.
Tucker, thank you so much for coming on the Courage and Nate Shot Show. Mm. Anytime we get to hang out is always fun. At one point during the episode, I looked at you and I was like, wait, we are hanging out with Tucker and we're not drinking. This is weird.
It's really stupid. It is. Most times, it's not even like we start out the night hanging out together because you don't come to the west side. We just end up at the same engagement.
And
it's
like walk through the door at somebody's house party and like, boys,
it's nice that it's always a comforting feeling, man. I really do every time with you, I'm like, I love hanging out with this guy, and it's a shame we don't do it more, but we're both stubborn enough where we don't want
to
go
to the other side
and you don't want to go to west, so hey, you know what,
I love you guys. Maybe someday when we're working out, when they build that high speed rail in between the two,
the Hyperloop.
Where's that tunnel, Elon?
Elon Musk, get on it. We want to hang out with Jericho Moore. Thank you all so much for listening to the podcast. As always, Jericho, where can people find you on social media?
At Jericho on all socials and at Night Mode for the record label stuff.
Everyone, check out everything he's doing with his record label.
You guys will love it.
It's really special, and it's really awesome to see somebody in his position really go out and do something different that he's really passionate about.
Appreciate it.
Be sure to rate the podcast 5 stars on iTunes, the Courage and Nate Shot Show. Let us know who you want to see on the show down below. My name is Jack Courage Dunlop. This is Matthew Nate Shot Haig. This is Tucker Jericho Boner. And I'm going to go ahead and end the show here. Thanks for watching. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Bye. Goodbye.